Welcome to the lecture on cluster analysis and topic modeling as part of the industrial data science class here in TU Dortmund. We will first begin with a small motivation of cluster analysis. So the motivation is that we have some unordered data set, lots of things in here, just as in this bowl of fruit, and we want to know what is in there, what could be a possible structure of this data. And in this very well-known popular book, where we arrange the fruit and the bowl, as you can see to the right hand side, and sorted items by some type of, not all of them are fruit, there are also the dots and the cream and the spoon. But yeah, he sorted them by type, by some notion of type. He didn't sort them just by color or by size. So that could be different types of structure in the same data. And that's why this cover of this book kind of captures the idea of clustering quite nicely. It's about sorting data in some interesting way. So what are the application domains for cluster analysis? It's primarily it's a exploration tool, and in some cases it's also used for data aggregation to compress and reduce the data set to a more manageable, smaller size. The prototypical case that is most mentioned is probably customer segmentation. So in order to develop new products or in order to guide advertisements, we want to segment our customers into groups of customers with similar preferences, such that we can develop new products, for example, aimed at a particular subgroup of them, or develop a new product for this particular subgroup. And the context that is quite important, but where the named clustering is not used that much, is in resource planning. For example, the facility location problem can be seen as a form of clustering problem. Quantization is the idea where we aggregate and compress the data. For example, it was very popular to use this type of algorithms to reduce the color palette of an image to make the image smaller, in particular for GIF animations, for example, that tend to be quite large files, and by reducing the number of colors, you can make the files smaller. We can also use clustering algorithms to detect, for example, thunderstorms. If we have weather radar data and similar events, we could detect clusters, flocks of earthquakes in seismographic data, all this type of events that occur in batches, in small batches. So we can't, it wouldn't be a clustering problem to detect a large earthquake, but these are often coming along with some flocks of very, very small earthquakes, and a group of them in an area could be an indication that there could be something larger coming, but it's not up to the level yet where we could use it for prediction. It can also be used to use this in portfolio management, not so much to actually predict stock development, but to analyze, for example, the diversity of a portfolio. If you have very similar stocks in there, the combined risk of the portfolio is higher than if they are diverse. So clustering stocks could be interesting to see, to check that a portfolio is not too concentrated around related stuff. And it's also used, for example, in grouping similar documents. They could be at different levels. Near duplicate detection, for example, is done in news articles. And if you go to a website that aggregates news, you will not be presented the same news article 10 times, even though it appeared in probably 10 different newspapers, because it detected them as being near duplicates. We also have want to group them by some topic. So there is some clustering of news articles usually done in here. And we can take that further. If you want to be able, for example, to detect plagiarism, to detect websites that just rip off other websites by copying their text and all of that. But there are some differences to other tasks. On one hand, there is the classification task that we learned about in the previous lecture, for example, where the classes are given by the training labels. In clustering, we do not have such labels. We do not know what we are looking for. And in market basket analysis last week, or last lecture, we were looking also for frequent patterns, and it's kind of related to clustering, but they are expected to overlap much more, and we do not expect a complete coverage of the data by frequent patterns because there could be unfrequent combinations in there. And the focus there was on generating the interesting association rules. And association rules is not something that we would consider in the context of cluster analysis. It's also related but different kind of from topic modeling by the idea that in clustering, usually we would have the, usually not always, we would have objects assigned to one cluster, whereas in topic modeling, it is very, very common that a document may contain multiple topics and some words may be relevant and other words may not be relevant. There is a closer match then to soft clustering and subspace clustering for some of these subtasks. So what is a cluster? And that is actually an extremely difficult question. There is no good answer to this because everybody will have a slightly different notion of cluster, and in every application you will have a different notion of cluster. So cluster analysis is, or clustering, segmentation, quantization is the data mining task to divide the data into clusters such that similar and related objects should be in the same cluster and dissimilar unrelated objects should be in different clusters. That's the easy part, very abstract notion. The clusters are not defined beforehand. It's not classification. But the algorithm needs to define the partitions. And then these partitions usually need to have some statistical, geometric, whatever property that sets them apart from the remainder. So for example, the cluster could be described with least square deviation, so it should be a compact, a low variance. So this is low variance. It should have a low variance, or it should have a high density, or it should be well separated from other clusters. So there should be some type of gap in between of clusters. So if you look to the for the image on the right hand side, we do have two clusters in here. One is the circular cluster and one is this banana shaped cluster. And that is actually a pretty difficult example already for many algorithms because of the cluster shape. And these two are separated with a gap that has very few data points. And the other property that we can see in this example very nicely is that the points inside the banana, they can be very far apart, but they are somewhat connected within the cluster. So there are different notions of what a cluster could be. The banana cluster on the right hand says it has a high variance, so it does not have this property, but it has a high density, it has connectivity, and it has separation from the circular cluster. Clustering algorithms have different notions of clusters. So if you use a different algorithm, it won't find the same clusters because it has a different notion of what is a good cluster and it tries to find good clusters. So it depends on what the cluster actually considers to be a cluster. Does it consider only the center point? Does it consider the actual shape of the cluster? And the other difference between algorithms is the induction principle. So how does the algorithm find the clusters? You could implement algorithms that just try to brute force, try all combinations, they will just be unusable slow. So you need to have some smarter way of doing this. Usually this type of clustering problems is a very hard problem. So you have to make some cut off some compromise to, in your definition to what it finds. And because of all of that, the results can vary substantially. And it's not because we don't have a good algorithm yet that the results vary. But actually, our expectations of what is a good result vary. And that can already be found in early literature. So in the 60s already, Bonner said, no definition is always the best. So user A wants to use a different cluster definition than user B, and they will consider different definitions better than the other. So the users will already disagree. And if the users disagree, there cannot be a universal best definition. And similarly, much later, quality is subjective, quality of a cluster, and lies in the eye of the beholder. So what I consider a good cluster may not be what you consider to be a good cluster.